I want to welcome the members of the class of 2017 and their parents and all of our transfer students who are newly enrolled. If all of our freshmen and transfer students would please stand, we'd like to formally welcome you and thank you for being here. University, and you won't regret your decision. My wife Mary and our five children love it here, like my wife Mary, who's seated here in the front row. You gotta meet Mary Towey, she's a superstar. Mary. We basically got used to everything here, including the alligator in the canal behind our house, the occasional bear prowling around in a search of garbage. But here's the good news. In the winter, on a Saturday morning, you can wake up and be in the Gulf of Mexico in about 30 minutes. In South Bend, you can wake up in the winter and in 30 minutes be stuck in snow in Gary, Indiana. You chose well. I know I joke about Notre Dame. Actually, my son is a junior at Notre Dame. That's right. He went there because he couldn't get into Ave Maria. That's not my Notre Dame material. We have a number of special individuals here that I'd like to recognize. I want to begin by welcoming the chairman of our Board of Trustees, Michael Timmis. Where is Michael Timmis? Michael? He's accompanied by Bailey, who's a student, a part-time student here at the university, and his wife Laura and family are real blessings to all of us, and certainly to Mary and me. We have a number of members of our senior leadership here at the university. I'm sure you've had an opportunity to meet many of them, as well as members of our distinguished faculty. There is one student member I want to recognize who deserves our special recognition and thanks. He's a Marine who was awarded a Purple Heart for his valor and service during the first of his two tours in Afghanistan. As you know, this medal is awarded to those wounded or killed in the service of our country. Thankfully, he's with us tonight. And he's with his sister Emily, a student here at Ave Maria University. And so I'd like you to join me in welcoming a very special individual, a hero, to our campus, Alex Morton. Where are you, Alex? Of all of the men and women who serve this country so beautifully. And of course, there's another Marine I want to talk about, who's our founder and chancellor, Tom Monahan. Tom's faith and courage and commitment made this university possible. I met with Tom earlier this week, and he asked me to convey his warmest greetings to you. He'd like to be here, but he's in Michigan with his wife. They just celebrated their 51st wedding anniversary. And this weekend, he'll be with our football team in Chicago when they play at Soldiers Field. And by the way, Tom's been asked to do the coin toss before the game, and I asked him if he would give us the coin when he's done so we can spend it. But the truth is, we wouldn't be here. This was a tomato field. We wouldn't be here if it weren't for Tom Monahan and his faith, his generosity. He's donated over $300 million to this campus, his own personal wealth. He's donated in the service of you and for those of you students who have scholarships from the university. Tom's helping pay for those. He's giving millions more this year. So I hope that as you go to bed tonight and as you study here, you remember his generosity in your prayers and you don't waste his money or your family's money as you study here and that you make them proud. So, and I hope you parents are proud of your decision here to trust your son or daughter. And we have many families here who have sent to us more than one student. I'd love the parents who have sent us more than one student to Ave Maria University to please stand and be recognized. Parents who have sent us more than one. Love the O team when they howled. But it was great to be with the O team this morning, helping families move in. I spent some time out there and watching the parents and students coming from virtually every state in the country and from many countries. In fact, the majority of our students are from out of state. And so we legitimately are a national university. And you can feel, I think, the excitement in the air because this is also our 10th year as a university. We have a number of special activities planned to celebrate this milestone, including campus lectures by best-selling authors like George Weigel and Arthur Brooks. We'll have our festival celebrations on All Saints Day and the Annunciation. And we will have many other activities throughout the year. Our choir performs. They're fantastic. And in the spring, we have Shakespeare, students performing Shakespeare. And the fun starts Sunday night with a kickoff concert headlined by one of our graduates, Roman Samuels, and his band. So you'll want to be there. The Lord has blessed this university, and we're grateful. As much has been done in 10 years. Now we have about 1,000 students. We're proudly Catholic. We're committed to the magisterium of the church. We're rooted in our faith. And we're open to seekers of the truth, wherever they are on their spiritual journey. So Catholics and non-Catholics are welcome here. We love diversity. We believe if you students are surrounded only by people who look like you and think like you and vote like you, you may not grow. And last night when I was welcoming families in, people from Ecuador and the students coming in from families, I watched this family today when Emily was brought in by her family from Haiti, and the joy there on their faces, the tremendous promise. Diversity helps us discover that we have in common are things far greater than our differences, because we've been created in the image and likeness of God. So we're proud of our values and our value. I think you parents know that we're among the most affordable small private universities in America. You also know that our campus is safe and the moral climate compatible with faith in Jesus Christ. So to you parents, I simply want to say that Ave Maria University will support the values you instilled in your son or daughter and not undermine them in the manner common on many campuses in America today. We also will stand up for our beliefs, whatever consequences may come. As you may have heard today, Ave Maria University went to federal court to challenge the contraceptive services mandate and the government's attempt to coerce us into abandoning our religious beliefs. We're not going to. Some have said our lawsuit is a modern version of David and Goliath. And I guess that's true, and I actually like how that story ended. And I think we discover at a campus like this, where things are often little and hidden, the power and glory of God, and how God is resplendent in humble environments. At Ave Maria, that starts with the men and women who comprise our faculty. They are actually giants in their fields. They hold degrees from places like Harvard and Yale and Columbia and Cornell and Princeton, Notre Dame, Boston College, and Cambridge. And these men and women and their colleagues could be professors anywhere, and instead they freely chose to teach, research, and write at Ave Maria, and to raise their families here. They are scholars who take their faith seriously. You students will soon learn your good fortune having them in your life. We also have a team of committed, competent administrators. You've met some of them today, like Dr. Dauphiné, Vice President for Academic Affairs, and Bill Kirk, and Julie Cosden of the Student Life staff. They're great people, and it's a pleasure to go to work every day here. Now, perhaps you students are wondering just who exactly is in this room tonight with you, so let me tell you a few things about your classmates. We have our second largest entering class ever, with over 325 students, maybe 330, which brings our total enrollment, as I said, to around 1,000. And to put that number in perspective, two springs ago, our enrollment was 627. The average GPA of our entering freshmen is higher than last year's group average, so we have a lot of bright students here on campus. Today I moved in Amber Presto, a salutatorian from Lakeland. I'm sure helped drive up our numbers. Senator G.A. de los Reyes, winner of the prestigious Harvard Book Award, who, by the way, plays football for us. Another thing that's amazing about Ave Maria in my short time here, I've heard many stories about students finding their husband or spouse here. And I'm not making this up. Over the summer, we had 18 students marry someone they met while at Ave Maria. And in the last 6 months, another 24 have gotten engaged. Woo! 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 University since it was founded. One in five of our graduates has married somebody they met here, so look around here, you never know. I will tell you this, if you have a boyfriend or a girlfriend back home, ditch him. We'll take care of him, we'll handle those things. I say it in jest, but the truth is, we care about you and your vocation, whether it is to be a mom or a dad or a priest or religious or how you live your lay vocation. This university is interested in the whole person, body, mind, and soul. A great deal of your education, in fact, will occur outside the classroom. And I think the role of an authentically Catholic university is to make sure you're being educated in those fashions through service, that you can participate in projects to help the poor. So I want to introduce to you Grace Jeffers, who's heading up our service learning project here on campus and will be helping you volunteer. Grace, if you'd stand up for a second. Navi Maria, her daughter Grace, is a student here, and she's also lived a life of service. She has 11 children. And she and I hopefully we'll see you on Saturday at the field house at 11 o'clock when we do the Meals of Hope Service Project. We'll be making bag lunches for hundreds of individuals who have not enough food. And these meals will go to Immokalee and other places in Collier County who are our neighbors. And I think at Ave Maria University, if we're true to Catholic social teaching, we help you discover the value of life, unborn life, very important, the sanctity of life, to cherish life, and also to see in the faces of our poor that they're not a burden to us, but in fact a gift to us. I had the privilege, as Bill mentioned, to work at the White House around a lot of the most powerful people on earth, including the President of the United States, the leader of the free world. I reported to him, traveled with him, observed the grandeur of the presidency, but I have to tell you that in my life I've discovered that the most powerful people I know are poor because they have the power to transform our lives. They're also empty to receive God. And they have the power also, I think, to unleash in each one of our students a capacity for mercy and compassion that they didn't know they had. And they also teach us about what really matters in life. It's true, I had the privilege to work for Mother Teresa of Calcutta for 12 years. And to watch her legendary compassion in action. And I traveled with her at times to see, as she engaged different cultures, different people, different faiths, her tremendous love, her ability, I think, to encounter in the individual what she described as Jesus in his distressing disguise of the poorest of the poor. She taught us how much we had in common and helped us remove the things that divided us. So I do invite you students to leave your comfort zone here on campus, consider mentoring children in Immokalee and finding service projects with Grace Jeffers' help, because these opportunities will allow you to put your faith into action. Last May, I had the privilege to go with 12 of our students to Calcutta to work in Mother Teresa's missions, and we'll be having that trip again this year. We'll have a meeting in a couple weeks. You may want to come and hear from the students. They're going to talk about their experiences and what they encountered there. My wife Mary is going to be taking a group to Haiti this year of students, again to work with the Missionaries of Charity. We've seen with students when they take that step of faith of service, the tremendous gifts they receive and how much they grow, it can be life-changing. We're not indifferent at this university about your faith. That seems to be self-evident if you're a Catholic university, but at times you feel there is almost an indifference, but not here. We hope and pray that you grow not only intellectually, but spiritually. And so for our Catholic students, There's an expectation that you go to Mass on Sunday. We expect it. It's part of our culture here that you go to Mass on Sunday. We'll encourage you to go. We hope to model this for you, but you won't be coerced to going. We'll invite you. We'll hopefully, week after week, make sure you come with us to church, but at the end of the day, it's up to you, because we won't force you. Religion is something that can't be coerced. It has to be a free will gift. It's enough for your parents to say, when the question of Scripture, well, who do you say that I am? If the student says, well, my parents say that you're the Son of the Living God, that's an answer that works in childhood, but in adulthood, Jesus says, but who do you say that I am? And you have to answer that question yourself. One thing I've learned is you can't impose virtue in religion. A virtue imposed leads to an appearance of virtue and nothing more. Virtue and holiness reside in the heart and have to be cultivated in freedom. And what is freedom? At many colleges and universities in America, students believe that freedom means they're free to do whatever they please. And that can mean binge drinking or hooking up and rejecting God and objective moral truth. I think you all are familiar with the parable of the prodigal son, and a modern version might be the prodigal student. The son in the parable did what many college kids in America do, grab money from the parents in order to squander it on dissolute living. And the father, Jesus reminds us, let his son go, probably knowing full well that his son was about to plunge headfirst into an abyss of sin. And the father watched his son become a slave to sin and abandon the freedom he was endowed with as a child of God. The father knew that virtue not born of freedom wasn't virtue. He came to his senses. He discovered virtue. And Jesus' parable also spoke of a second son, a son who was bitter and who experienced freedom in the father's house as a form of slavery, and who, in fact, probably wanted to do what his brother had done. And that's the danger if faith is simply law-based and it sees God as a grim rule giver. God, of course, is much greater. He's a God of love, and he invites us to love him in freedom. And with that, you see joyful Christianity. And we see that on our campus. Our students, we don't have the binge drinkers. We have binge prayers. Come on, Emily. Get out of the chapel. Three rosaries in an hour. This prayer pong, it's too much. Prayer pong. Did you hear it? Prayer pong? Or they have a different excess. They don't do binge drinking, they do binge thinking. They read the classics they haven't been assigned. It's a book up culture. So I tried this for the first time here tonight. I'm not sure I'm going to do this again. But my point is, this university presents opportunities for growth and freedom. We urge you to grab these opportunities. I know we live in a high-tech world with earbuds and iPhones and iPads and tweeters and all this. And don't get me wrong, we employ modern technology here. The students ask for faster internet in the dorms. We have it this year. We have 113 new workstations. We love technology. And I think we know that if our students have to choose between internet service and flushing toilets, they'll go with the fast internet service. But I want to urge you, incoming students, not to be slaves to technology, but to cultivate silence and to learn to derive beauty from friendship and conversation. If you look around this room, you're going to discover that some of your best friends for life are seated here, and you're going to discover them. You'll also discover the beauty that can come through study and worship. Tomorrow, Father Garrity, our campus minister, will talk about how we have several masses every day with varied liturgies. Most masses will remind you of those you had at home, and we also have matin masses to remind you of church's great traditions. Some students, when they go to communion, will choose to kneel, and most stand. It's your choice. Either way, the Lord is reverence, and I hope you consider frequenting the sacraments often, if you're Catholic. I go to Mass daily because I need it. I depend on the Eucharist, and I'm grateful that the Church provides this to us who hunger and are in need. Ave Maria also has a Eucharistic chapel for quiet prayer and worship, and that too is changing lives on our campus, and many non-Catholic students participate in Bible studies with our focus missionaries and our teammates and friends, and that's a good thing too. A university, to be true to its liberal arts orientation, must prepare you to be a critical thinker. So you don't simply recite knowledge and theories, but actually believe them and defend them. A Catholic university must help you discover the complementary natures of reason and faith and invite you to encounter Jesus Christ, the fullness of truth. It's been my observation that young people do hunger for the truth, for things authentic. Too often, academia addresses only scientific truths and neglects theological truths. Last year, the Chronicle of Higher Education carried the cover story, quote, Salvaging God, and it told of how a group of scholars, many of them atheists, believed that, quote, maybe we should stop asking whether God exists and start asking whether it's useful to believe that he does. My friends, God does not need to be salvaged. Higher education needs to be salvaged. This kind of hostility toward theological truth, where religious belief is measured on strictly a utilitarian basis, is standard on too many campuses in our country. I've been speaking or lecturing at colleges and universities for over a decade, Harvard, Yale, Princeton, Dartmouth, Duke, you name them. I've spoken there, and in my travels, I often felt sorry for students who were trapped on campuses that have strayed from their faith-based roots and forgotten God and caved into the worst of modern culture. But the faculty and staff at Ave Maria want our students to set their minds on the higher things because the world needs saints. And I'm going to be closing with this theme. Our students will find no better guide for their journey on our campus than the Mother of God, Mary of Nazareth, who teaches us about life and its purpose. Your students are on this campus to be educated, and you students will be educated, but I hope you will also find time to ponder the fundamental questions of existence. Why are you here on this earth? Why did God create you? What is your purpose in life? Ave Maria will have failed you if in 4 years from now you are actively on the road to discovering answers. It's my joy to welcome you here. It's our privilege to be serving you on this campus. We're excited about what the future holds for you at Ave Maria University. Welcome to our community. God bless you and thank you.